Good evening and welcome back to Capitol Tonight, a statewide look at politics. I'm Tim Boyme. Another week, another busy week at the state legislature. I don't think we have the alternative at all anymore. We continue our conversations with lawmakers from across the state as House members work toward a budget proposal next week. Joining us this week, Republican House member from Mecklenburg County, Charles Jeter, and Orange County Democrat, Representative Greg Meyer. Representative, it's good to see you. Welcome back to the program.
Thanks for having us.
All right, so obviously HB2 is still dominating. Just before the break, Art Pope floated an idea to basically rescind the Charlotte Ordinance and then suspend or put a moratorium on HB2 to put a Blue Ribbon Commission study together to look at reasonable accommodations. Greg, let's start with you, because you obviously want this bill repealed. Is that something you would consider?
Not at this time. I believe a full repeal is necessary. For what we've heard overwhelmingly from the public and the business community is that they're opposed to discrimination. And for Charlotte to repeal its ordinance would mean that they would go back to a position of allowing more discrimination than what would be allowed under their ordinance. Why would they go backward when everyone in the world is telling us to go forward?
Representative Jeter, is something like this idea possible?
Well, I think that we have to decide whether or not we're trying to fix the politics or the policy. You know, and I appreciate Representative Meyer's position. However, we've got to find a way to fix the problem that is created by the Charlotte Ordinance and then HB2 secondarily in this state. And so I would be an advocate for anything that allows us to sit around and try to resolve the problem and stop the hurting in North Carolina that these issues have caused.
So in other words, sort of step back to where we were pre-March and move forward from there.
I think we've got to have a more circumspect conversation about the issues surrounding HB2 where it comes to LGBT rights and all those issues. And I certainly understand the North Carolina, I believe, and I think certainly Representative Meyer agrees, we've got to be inclusive of everyone. But we do have to be mindful of the moral convictions of a lot of the parts of this state. And so I think it's, you know, if there was an easy solution, we would have found it. I think the more we talk about trying to find ways to resolve the issue, the better off we're all going to be.
Representative Meyer, if we went back to where it was, I mean, I think most people believe that pre-HB2 and the ordinance that transgender people were already going into the bathroom of their gender identity. So would, at least for the time being, to look at the issue, would it not be better to do that? Or do you really believe the public pressure is going to force a repeal?
I believe that the public pressure wants a repeal. Force is tough because you have politicians who aren't willing to say that they were wrong or admit that they should change their minds. That's the hard part. But part of this is that we're still stuck in a dialogue around bathrooms when the heart of House Bill 2 isn't really about bathrooms. If we added gender identity and sexual orientation to the new state non-discrimination policy, that would give us a step forward as well.
So is it fair to say then, based on that statement, if we did that and left Section 1 alone, which is the bathroom piece, and we did address Section 3, which is the state court protected class issue, as you said, is that something you could support?
I would support a repeal of the whole bill. I believe the bathroom piece is problematic, but I also understand it's unenforceable. And I hope that people are going to the bathroom today that they feel is the right one for them to use. I don't want people to be walking around our state feeling like their state government is dictating to them whether they should use a bathroom, whether they're safe or unsafe.
The only thing I'd say about that, going to the force issue, is we've got to understand there are parts of North Carolina that fully support, or not fully support, you know, 80% of the constituents in some of these rural areas support at least Section 1 of the bill, which is in essence the bathroom piece that dealt with the Charlotte Ordinance. And so, you know, if your job is to represent your constituency, a lot of these legislators are representing their constituency by saying they aren't willing to repeal Section 1. So in Greg and I's district, we may have a different mindset because of our constituency and our job to represent them, which is our responsibility. But we've got to understand there's a lot of different pockets of North Carolina, and we've got to be mindful of all of them.
Has this dominated Jones Street? I mean, I know you filed an important bill about education, the budget's coming up, but is it still dominating Jones Street?
Ever since we passed House Bill 2, every conversation that I've had, both on Jones Street and off of Jones Street, has referenced House Bill 2. I mean, literally almost every conversation. And then, you know, you think about what has it done to the media cycle. We try and introduce other bills, new ideas, almost nothing cracks through.
Makes the point something has to be done, right?
Well, and you know, you got good bills out there that deserve to be heard, like my House Bill 954, which would cancel the toll project on 77. Greg Meyer and I've got a couple of good bills that we've worked on together. So it
he
is
throwing that toll in there.
Listen,
he's a professional.
My job is to defend my constituents, and North Mac wants that toll road canceled. Everyone should go tell their legislators to support House Bill 954.
I think you need to talk to Senator Berger on that.
Listen, my job is to get out of the House. I trust Senator Tarp can get it out of the Senate. But you know, there is this cloud, if you will, that encompasses everything we do. And we've got the budget coming up next week. And it is difficult to do the work that we need to do when this is taking so much time. And I understand why it's taking time. I'm not, you know, dismissing that. But, you know, I hope we can get to a point where we can resolve this issue and move on to the other important business of the state.
So, Charlie, what will it take for your colleagues in the Republican caucus to say, we got this one wrong? And we need to fix it.
Well, we haven't
even seen a serious proposal.
Well, I will say this. There's certainly numerous proposals being worked on. And I think that in all fairness, I think this is less about saying who got it right, who got it wrong. I mean, I think if we're looking for mea culpas and those type of things, we'll probably be waiting a long time. I'm more concerned about resolving the issue and getting rid of Section 2 and Section 3 of the bill, perhaps how we address Section 1 of the bill. I'm less concerned about apologies and that kind of stuff, because I think you would even agree any apology given is gonna fall on deaf ears. No one's going to believe it, even if it's being said. I'm more concerned about fixing the problem than I am about looking backwards.
I don't know. I think it matters a lot that you've already come out and said, I don't agree with this to some extent. I think people want to know that their leaders are able to look at a situation and say, I didn't get it right, I need to fix it. And specifically, if we've hurt you, I think people want to know that we're willing to say, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to hurt you. I didn't want to hurt my own people, my own state.
Well, you know, as you just alluded to, I've been very consistent in my position. I've been very public in my position on this and the fact that, you know, I wish, you know, the bill hadn't come to fruition.
What does this mean for Charlotte and other issues? Taxes, other bills. I mean, is Charlotte now the target for Republican lawmakers?
I think target's a harsh word. I will say this, I kind of giggled a little bit, and I don't mean that disrespectfully, when they gave us their legislative agenda for the short session. My comment back to Dana Fenton, who I do think has probably
the hardest
lobbying job in the building right now, is maybe your legislative agenda is, how can you not hurt Charlotte? Because look, Charlotte is, and as you both of y'all know, there was already the concept of the great state of Mecklenburg. So the premise that Charlotte was like before this building, it was you know, a false premise. This certainly hasn't helped. You know, I take pride in the fact that Charlotte is part of my district, and I'm going to do everything I can to make sure I protect Charlotte and its citizens against any nefarious intent by any member. That's my job. That's my responsibility. I take that seriously, and I intend to do just that.
Well, one silver lining you might find in House Bill 2 then is that some of our colleagues in Raleigh now understand just what an important economic engine Charlotte is to the state.
Well, there's no question. You know, it's and I guess the other thing I've learned is don't go out of the country.
You're out of town when this passed.
My wife and I went on a trip for her 40th birthday planned months ahead. I leave the country for 10 days and I come back and, you know, here we are. So,
you need to keep Representative Jeter in town, I guess.
That's right.
Well, guys, I hope you come back in a couple of weeks, because I promise we will talk about other things that are not HB2. But in the meantime, good to see you.
Thanks, Tim.
Thank you, Tim.
That's all the time we have for tonight. Thanks so much for spending some time with us. We'll see you back here tomorrow night. Have a great evening.